The first thing I need to explain about electricity is that in the wrong hands, it can be deadly. If you don't know what you're doing, don't understand how it works, leave it alone. Get some help from someone who is qualified and that really knows. I was called out to look at a problem a lady was having with her trailer. She'd moved her RV into the backyard of her daughter's place and had a neighbor put a 30-amp receptacle on a post for her to plug in. This neighbor thought the plug was 220 volts, like the type you see on a dryer. As you can see, they look somewhat similar, and he wired it in that way. When the lady connected the RV to the post, the TV, microwave, and other appliances that were plugged in were destroyed, and it blew the circuit breaker in the breaker box. Now, not knowing what the neighbor had done, I reset the breaker, and as soon as I touched the trailer, which was metal, I was immediately lit up like a Christmas tree. Thank the stars it was me that touched that coach and not her. It could have been deadly. Now, if you have working knowledge of AC and DC power, you might find the first few minutes of this boring and a little bit long-winded, but be patient. I think if you understand a little about the electrical system on your unit, you'll feel more comfortable and confident. Also, you might be able to save some money on repairs. Most problems can be solved or found with a test light, a hairdryer, and some common sense. We'll start the demonstration explaining the difference between AC and DC power. AC power, or alternating current, is the same stuff you have in your home. It runs your TV, microwave, lights, and so on. We will continue to call this AC power. DC power, or direct current, is the power you have in your automobile. It powers the starter, lights, ignition, and basically everything in the vehicle. We will call this DC power. RVs have both power systems in them, and I believe it's important to understand a little bit on how the two interact. In the early years, RVs were intended to dry camp, meaning that most appliances ran off propane, and the few lights they had ran off the batteries, or DC power. Well, RVs are bigger and fancier, and they have more toys in them, but the concept is still basically the same. They still are designed to run out in the backwoods, and they need DC power to run them. Did you know the fridge in your unit must have DC power to run, even on propane? They have a little brain box or a module in them that is powered by the battery to make them work. Same with the furnace. It's DC power and, of course, propane. Same goes for the water heater. If you have the DSI model, direct spark ignition, the type you just flip the switch. Most, if not all, lights are DC powered. And when the battery goes dead, nothing works. If equipped, when your tow vehicle or motorhome engine is started, the alternator charges the batteries, but they will never get fully charged that way. I'll explain that later. That's why we have converters. That is, converters with a C, not inverters with an I. People get the two confused all the time. I will explain inverters later on as well. Converters convert AC power to DC power. Quite simply, a converter is a battery charger. When you plug in your unit, the converter charges your batteries and runs the 12-volt or DC-powered accessories. Converters are designed to be plugged in for long periods of time or short stays. They have a voltage regulator in them and, if working properly, will not overcharge the batteries but will top them right off. Understand that batteries need a long, steady charge to bring them back to full strength. So, let's say you're planning to go into the woods for the long weekend. It'd be a good idea to plug your unit in for a week before going. That way, the batteries would be fully charged, and if you use the system conservatively, you could make it through the entire weekend. An inverter works in reverse. It takes DC power and turns it into AC power. They come in different sizes and shapes, and if you have one of the bigger ones, you can watch TV, cook in the microwave, and so on. They're a great thing to have, but they have to be set up properly. They require a great deal of battery power, and they're quite expensive. If you do a lot of dry camping, they're great. But if you go to full hookup RV parks, you don't need them. They make AC power where there is none. Let's assume you have a travel trailer, no generator, and no solar power. If you are a dry camper, batteries are the heart of the system. Without them, the RV is dead. So it's important to learn how to make them last as long as possible. There's a lot of information on batteries, but the only things you really need to know is amperage draw, reserve capacity, and how they affect you. First off, let's talk about DC voltage. Think of volts as measurement of strength. The higher the number, the stronger the system. 12 volt, 24, 36, and so on. On RVs, we use only 12 volts. It's very important to remember that. If you think of amperage draw, or amps, as the speed that electricity goes through the wire, it's like a speedometer. It's a way of measuring the speed of the current going through the system. The higher the number, the faster the electricity is flowing through the wires. One light bulb might use 1.5 amps, two bulbs, 3 amps, and so on. While we are talking about amps or amperage, let's touch on fuses for a minute. They come in different sizes and shapes. Fuses work like a speed zone. If the system only needs up to 15 amps of electricity, a 15 amp fuse is installed. For whatever reason, say the wire is shorted to ground or the system is overloaded, and the amperage exceeds the fuse amount, it burns out. You see, when electricity passes through a wire, it creates heat. The higher the speed or amperage, the more heat is created. That little wire in the fuse is just like my wife. It's designed only to take so much, and then it blows. If something quits that is DC powered, the first place you should go to is the fuses. Depending on your coach, you might find fuses all over the place. You should make a point of knowing where they are and what they do. If yours are the ATO type like these, you can probe them with a test light to see if they're good or not. I like this method the best. Make sure you have a good ground and probe both ends of the fuse. Fuses can look fine, but they can be burnt out. Here, I found a bad one. Glass fuses can be tested the same way. Just touch the tip on the metal part and check both sides. And remember, never use a test light on AC power. It's for DC or battery power only. Now here's some neat devices called circuit breakers. They can be installed in place of a fuse. The nice thing about them is that if there is a problem and the speed limit is broken or the amps have been exceeded, they blow just like a fuse. But after they cool down, they automatically reset themselves. If the problem is a once in a while thing like a power surge, everything goes back to normal. But if it's something serious, it will continue to blow and reset and will protect the system until it is fixed or the breaker wears itself out. Remember that the system that you have in your RV is a 12-volt system. Whatever combination of batteries you put in your RV, it must always come out as 12 volts DC. Now, what do I mean by that? I'm going to explain parallel and series hookups and at the same time explain reserve capacity. Throughout the years, I've seen people hook up batteries wrong and set fire to their campers. When you jump or boost one vehicle with another, you hook positive to positive and negative to negative. That is a parallel hookup. When we put more than one battery on our units, we do the same. We hook them in parallel. This serves two purposes. It keeps our system 12 volts, but best of all, we double the reserve capacity. Reserve capacity is how we rate or guess the time a battery will last. Let's say you have a 12-volt battery that has a reserve capacity of 175 minutes. In theory, the battery will last for 175 minutes at a 25-amp draw. Now if, and not likely, you had 16 lights lit at the same time, and each light draws 1.5 amps, your battery would be dead in 175 minutes. Now, if you hook two 12-volt batteries each with 175 reserve capacity in parallel, you get 12 volts and 350 minutes reserve capacity. You see, the voltage stayed the same, but the reserve doubled. Let's add another one. Now we have 12 volts and 525 minutes reserve. Do you see what's happening here? As long as the batteries are hooked in parallel, the voltage stays the same, but the reserve increases. Important to mention, never mix reserve capacities and sizes of batteries. That means if you have, for instance, 175 reserve and 150 reserve, don't put them together. They will fight each other and cause problems. Okay, that's the 12-volt batteries. Now, we're able to put 6-volt golf cart batteries in our RVs. They have incredible reserve capacity, but the clincher is we have to buy two of them, and that's why we have to talk about series hookups. Remember when I said whatever combination of batteries we come up with, it must always come out as 12 volts? Here's what I mean. Let's say we have two 6-volt batteries. If you take them and hook them the way we did the 12-volt ones, we would still have 6 volts. Well, that won't work. But if we hook the batteries in series, we will get what we need. Here's how we do that. With the batteries close to each other, a jumper wire is put between one of the positive posts of one battery and the negative post of the other. Notice that leaves a positive and a negative post free. We've just made a 12-volt battery system with two 6-volt batteries and a reserve capacity of 480 minutes. Unlike the parallel system, when you hook in series, you double the voltage, but the reserve stays the same. If you need more reserve capacity, you need to hook another set of batteries in parallel. Now you have both hookups involved. This is called a series parallel hookup. We now have a 12-volt system with a 960-minute reserve capacity. And that's why a lot of people do this. This system takes up a little more space, costs more, but you get 260 minutes more reserve capacity, or 4.5 hours more. That can make a big difference when you're dry camping. Now, let's move on to AC power. Remember my story about the lady getting her power hooked up wrong? AC can be deadly if in the wrong hands. If you don't know what you're doing, get help. The AC power in your coach is the same as what you use in your home. The one little difference is the GFI, ground fault interrupt, or GFCI, ground fault circuit interrupt. Most houses have them in the kitchen, bathroom, and other places, and so do RVs. The difference may be that in RVs, several other receptacles can be tied into one GFI. They're just a super sensitive circuit breaker. They're designed to pop or blow quicker than the circuit breaker in the panel. They're a great device, and I'm sure they've saved many lives, but if you don't know about them, they can cause you some grief. Now, I've been called out several times to find out one side of the customer's coach has no power, only to find they didn't check the reset button on the main receptacle, like this one. It's not uncommon to find a kitchen receptacle tied into an outside plug, and when it rains, the GFI pops, or a curling iron popped the one in the bathroom, and the TV won't work. I've seen as many as 5 GFI circuits on large motorhomes. You should find all of yours and find out what they run. You can test to see if they're working by pushing the test button, and the reset button should pop out. All the receptacles related to that GFI should stop working. Push the reset button and everything should come back on. If not, get someone qualified to look at it. Your circuit breakers are the same as the ones in your house. Again, I've seen people not resetting them properly. Don't be fooled. Sometimes they look okay, but the only way to know for sure is to move them all the way to the off position and then to the on. I just wanted to touch on the different types of AC power services that RVs use. Most of the units come out with a 30 amp service like this one. If you're not at an RV park and need power, you can adapt to what most of us call a 15 amp adapter and plug into your house. Do you remember me talking about amp draw in the DC power section and that more amps create heat? The same principle applies with AC power. When you use the 15 amp adapter, you need to limit the amount of power you use. You shouldn't use your air conditioner. It can draw as much as 20 amps. Your toaster can draw as much as 15 amps by itself, and so on. If you overload the system, it will most likely blow the breaker in the place you are plugged into and literally melt the 15 amp adapter. If you have a larger trailer or motorhome, you might have a 50 amp service that looks like this. They're designed to allow you to do just about anything in your coach. You might be able to run both air conditioners, do a load of laundry, watch a movie, and make popcorn all at the same time. But in some RV parks, they're hard to find. So we have adapters that bring us down from 50 amp service to a 30 amp service, and again to a 15 amp service. Just keep in mind that every time you adapt down, you have to limit the power usage. Another thing to remember is to use the shortest extension cord possible. There's a thing called voltage drop that would make me drag this thing on more than I already have. Trust me, if you can use a 25-foot cord instead of a 100-footer, do it.